Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome the owner of 2018 Tang Prize in Sinology, Dr. Stephen Owen, and our guests. Please have your seat. 让我们以热烈的掌声欢迎今天的主讲人跟嘉宾进场。首先，让我们以热烈的掌声欢迎中央研究院中国文哲研究所胡晓珍所长。国立台湾大学郑宇瑜讲座教授，中央研究院黄静新副院长，唐奖汉学得奖主宇文所安先生 Dr. Stephen Owen。国立台湾师范大学宋耀廷副校长，国立台湾师范大学文学院陈秋兰院长，国立台湾师范大学徐国能国文系教授，唐奖教育基金会陈振川执行长，请以热烈的掌声欢迎其他与会贵宾。Good morning, our distinguished guests. Master's Forum of 2018 Tang Prize in Sinology would like to invite Vice President of NTNU, Song Yaoting, to give a welcome remark. Let's welcome Song Yaoting. 让我们欢迎国立台湾师范大学宋耀廷副校长为我们做开场致辞。
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's the great honor of NTNU to host the third Master's Forum of Tang Prize.In Sinology. On behalf of National Taiwan Normal University and President Wu, I'd like to welcome all of you to this important event. As we know, the Tang Prize is a global award because all of the laureates are nominated and approved based on the originality of their work and their contributions to the global society. The Tang Prize in Sinology recognizes a lot of fields, including Chinese literature, Chinese thought, history, religion, and philosophy. The 2018 laureateProfessor Stephen Owen has made great accomplishments and tremendous contribution in the field of Chinese literature, specifically in the field of Tang Dynasty poetry. We know that he is a worldwide renowned professor.In Du Fu Shi. And today, joining Stephen Owen and the forum are distinguished professors and young scholars from Taiwan. I believe we will be inspired and get a lot of insights from those activities. It's a featured university in the fieldOf humanities and the social sciences. NTNU is honored to have this opportunity to collaborate with the Education Foundation of Tang Prize to host this important event. Therefore, I'd like to take this opportunity to express my sincere appreciation to the CEOOf the Education Foundation, Professor 陈振川, for choosing NTNU as their partner for this significant event. Once again, I'd like to give you my warm welcome and thank you for your participation. Thank you.
Thanks for Dr. Song. Next, we would like to invite Dr. Chen Qiulan to give a welcome remark. Let's welcome Dr. Chen. 让我们欢迎文学院陈秋兰院长。
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed a great honor and pleasure for the College of Liberal Arts to co-organize and co-host this Master's Forum for the third Tang Prize in Sinology. Within the College of Liberal Arts here at NTAU, we offer many courses on Chinese literature, history, linguistics, and culture. Therefore, we have a lot of professors, faculty members with expertise in the field that are encompassed in Sinology. We're truly honored that this forum is being held here so that our students and faculty members have the first chance to listen to panelists led by Professor Owen. Professor Owen is renowned in Chinese literature. Today, he is going to open the forum with a talk on reading, starting from something small. I'm sure you'll find this talk very inspiring, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank those individuals who have attended to great details to make sure this event goes smoothly. For all of them, thank you very much. And to all of you, I extend my warm welcome. 各位贵宾、各位同学，欢迎来到第三届唐奖汉学唐奖汉学大师讲座。今天在场的论坛呢，是由宇文所安教授及国内杰出汉学学者所参与的一场座谈。那文学院非常荣幸有这个机会跟唐奖基金会共同主办这样子的活动。那我要特别感谢所有的工作人员，他们几个月的努力，为了确保今天活动可以顺利进行。谢谢大家，也欢迎大家来参加这场座谈。谢谢。
Thanks for Dr. Chen.Now we would like to invite Vice President of Academia Sinica, Dr. Huang Jingxing, to give us an opening remark. Welcome, Dr. Huang. 让我们欢迎中研院副院长黄静新先生。
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to attend 2018.Tang Prize Laureate Lectures. I'm very pleased and honored to introduce today's speaker, Professor Steve Owen. Actually, for today's audience, he needs no introductions. But as formalities, I have to say something about Professor Owen.Professor Steve Owen specializes in pre-modern literature, lyric poetry, and comparative poetics. Much of his work has focused on the middle period of Chinese literature, roughly about 200 to 1200. However, he has also written.On literature of the early period and the Qing. Owen earned a BA and a PhD in Chinese language from Yale University. He taught there from 1972 to 1982. Before coming to Harvard, in acknowledgement of his groundbreaking work that crossed the boundary of multiple disciplines. Owen was awarded the James Bryant Cornell University Professorship in 1997. The chair was once held by the famous philosopher John Rawls, and he's regarded as one of the greatest philosophers in the late 20th century. Steve Owen has been a Fulbright scholar, held the Guggenheim Fellowship, and received a Mellon Foundation Distinguished Achievement Award. Among many other awards and honors, he recently retired from Harvard in April 2018. After over four decades of writing about translating and training students to read Chinese literature, Steve has done as much as any other scholar of his generation to introduce the riches of the Chinese literary tradition to Western readers, both scholarly and popular, to reflect upon its contribution to the world's literary heritage and to revolutionize the way it is read. Now, he will give us the talk about reading, beginning with small things. Now, Professor Owen. Thank you. Let's talk.
Thank you all for coming. I would certainly like to thank Taishida for inviting me. Well, actually, I think inviting the person who gets the Tang Jiang, Tang Prize, if somebody else had gotten it, they would be invited. I'd like to thank the Tang Prize. And all the people here I've known for a long time. I'm no newcomer to Taipei. Been here many times. The Tang organization, I don't know what kind of event this is supposed to be. You know, if you're a teacher, you like to know your genre. There is the Jiangzuo. There's the Zuo Tan Hui. There's certain number kinds of talks, and this one I don't understand. The Tang Prize Committee said I could talk about how I started out, to my beliefs, advice to younger scholars, many things. But I think I would like to address what I see as the biggest problem for the study of Gudian Wenxue, or at least from the middle period and the middle period, yes, from Weijin Nanbei Chao through Song. I envy people like Professor Hu Xiaozhen who work in Mingqing, because no one knows anything about what they're working on, so that she can say new things all the time. It's always fresh. I envy the people working in Shenqin Wenxue, because they're always digging new things out of the ground. But if I give a talk on Wang Wei, everyone knows what I'm supposed to say before I say one word. The problem with classical literature is people come to it already knowing, expecting what you're going to deal with. Now this is called beginning with small things, and I want to talk about the genre I'm using. I'm only beginning. I won't finish anything. And I'm only talking about the small things, but not the very large things that follow from it. Okay? I often tell students to, when they're trying to begin again, I talk about beginning again, to go back to the time the poem was written or a piece of prose was written. That's not the ultimate end of interpretation, but it's one way to get out of all the things we think we know about teaching and reading classical literature. I say, start over again. This doesn't mean you don't have to go back and do the things you've always done. Forget what you think you know for the time being. Begin with the small things, and taken together, those small things may lead to large things. But, you know, and it may be not, the large things may be not what you expect. You may find something new. Now, I was talking about Wang Quanji. A lot of people read Wang Quanji. When I was teaching Wang Quanji, I had a student from China, from mainland China, who said, Professor Lao Shi, woman Wei Sheng Kan Suoyuda De Shi, Wei Sheng Buja Kan Nigga Ming Pian. Why aren't we reading just the famous poems? And I asked them, when did the famous poems become famous? Go away, come back, and tell me next week. Next week came around, we were back in class, and I asked the student, he says, oh yeah, they became famous in the Ming Dynasty. I said, did you look how the Wang Quanji was quoted before that? I said, no. I said, go back and look again. They found out Wang Quanji is always quoted, almost always quoted, as a complete set. Okay, so we can start with that, okay? Now, I'd like to walk through a sequence of questions that naturally arise when we read the Wang Quanji. Our standard habits. What do we think we know when we start to read a Wang Wei poem? Everybody who's studied Tang poetry knows what you're supposed to know. Wang Wei's Buddhism. He is, of course, Shifu, right? And so my question would be then, when did he become Shifu? And the answer, like so many answers in Chinese studies, is he became Shifu in the Ming Dynasty. How was his poetry described by his contemporaries? We have some really good examples of Wang Wei's poems described by his contemporaries. We have his brother presenting his collection of Wang Wei's poems to Dai Zong, the Tang Emperor. He doesn't mention Buddhism. We have a preface by Yin Fan in the He Ye Ying Ling Ji, talking about Wang Wei's poetry. He doesn't mention Buddhism. We have Du Fu writing up one of the poems in Jiaman on Wang Wei. Du Fu really liked Wang Wei and admired him. He doesn't mention Wang Wei's Buddhism. Nobody talks about Wang Wei's Buddhism. When you look at the poems, of course, you find that he does have many poems referring to Buddhism, but they're not the majority of his works. We find, when you look at poems referring to Buddhism, you have to distinguish those poems where he's writing on visiting a monastery or talking to a monk. Because when you're visiting a monastery, a Buddhist temple, you have to talk about Buddhism. It's not polite. Okay? When you're talking to a monk, you have to talk about Buddhism, because otherwise it's not polite. So if you want to talk about Wang Wei's Ziji to Buddhism, then you have to look at the poems which are not on visiting temples and not talking to monks, and they exist, but there are not a whole lot of them. Now, here I want to say, stop. 对不起. I believe in my heart, I don't know, but I believe in my heart that Wang Wei really was a committed Buddhist. That's not saying he isn't a real Buddhist. And I do believe that we don't know exactly when in his life he became a committed Buddhist. We don't know how that relates to the poems we read. Right? We can see that directly in some poems and indirectly in others. I think what I'm leading to here is when you study Tang poetry or Chinese literature, there is a strong tendency to associate one writer with one characteristic. And when you associate one writer with one characteristic, then you look for that characteristic in everything he writes. But the truth is, I think I have it down here, there is no writer in the whole Tang dynasty that can be described by one characteristic. I keep telling students when we do a Dufu class, I could make an anthology to prove to you that Dufu was a devoted Buddhist poet. I can even more easily make an anthology to prove to you that Dufu was a comic poet. That was, after all, the first thing that was anybody ever said about Dufu. The people today, I think it was writing in the 770s, people today think that Dufu is a funny poet, but I am going to show you Dufu actually is serious sometimes. So the world, you know, the Tang poetry, Sung poetry, Weijin Nanbaixia poetry that we receive and learn about in school may not be the same Tang poetry, the same vision of the history of poetry that people saw earlier on. Now, you don't have to be stuck with what they saw earlier on in the Tang dynasty, for example, but it's good to know that. It helps you free yourself from the word I hate most. You know what the word I hate most is? Chuantong. Because Chuantong doesn't say Ming Dynasty, or Qing Dynasty, or Tang Dynasty, or Song Dynasty. The whole past is Chuantong. And a lot of different things happened in Chuantong. So many things that it's pretty useless to call something Chuantong Da. Okay. So in reading Wang Wei's poetry, the better question to ask to begin with, I think, is how poems would have sounded to readers who were familiar with poetry as it was practiced from roughly 720 to 761. That is, from the time of Wang Wei's first maturity to his death, if he died in 761, which we don't know. We cannot know how a Wang Wei text would have sounded. We cannot be sure. But we have lots and lots of information which tells generally what people would, how people would respond. The simple questions to ask are, what's new? Now, I think one of the first questions, things we'd find, is contemporary readers, if looking at Wang Chuanji, would think there's never before been a set of poems that we know of that actually traveled through an estate using separate names of the sites in the estate. Contemporaries would never have seen that, but they would be very familiar with poems on estates. Those do happen in the pre-Tang period, but if you know your Tang history, you know what happened in Zhongzong's reign in the late years of Empress Wu, where all the peasants south of Chang'an, in the area we now call Chang'an, or they call Chang'an, were thrown off their farms, and the princesses built estates there. And when the princesses built their grand estates, the courtiers, like Sun Jiwan, decided to go farther south where land was cheaper and buy an estate and make a small estate. And it's the Sung Jiwan estate, which of course became Wang Wei's estate. Okay. If people had never seen a set of poems on an estate with places that had titles, what does that tell you? What does that suggest? And I'll answer my question. Is the titles would be very interesting in this. And the preface turns out to be a list of titles. That's all. So then let us look at one of the titles. Now, I just want to say this kind of set of poems on an estate did become very, very common 70 years later. When it became common, people were imitating Wang Wei's Wang Chuanji. In those later versions, the titles are clearly given to owners of an estate. That is, you'd buy land, you'd dig rivers for the sake of giving them titles, pile up boulders, and then you would give them names. You've all read about this in Honglomeng, right? Making a garden, giving places names. That's a very important thing. This comes from Wang Wei's Wang Chuanji. Believe it or not, it's the first time this happened. The people who did this probably thought that Wang Wei actually gave all the titles. But I think you'd find out that probably Wang Wei gave some of the titles, but not all the titles. So what kind of thing would I ask when I'm teaching? Well, I'd say, tell me about the words used in these titles. There are some striking things that would really strike a reader. They use words that are never found in poetry, never found in poem titles, and never found in polite prose. And many of these words are clearly rustic. I don't know how you translate rustic. They belong to farmers, right? Not to the grand elite in Chang'an who are reading this. Some of them are rustic, some of them are not rustic at all. Something like, Huazigang. Everybody, you know, there's only one place anybody ever mentions Huazigang. It is in a Shelling Yun poem. It is a Shelling Yun poem in the Wenxuan. Everybody knew that poem. So if Wang Wei claims to have Huazigang in Lantian, you know where Lantian is, everybody. It's right near Xi'an now. I just was there about 3-4 weeks ago. Yeah, not in Wangchuan, but rather farther up. And it's close to the capital. It's close to Chang'an. Okay. And Jinju Ling. Now, frankly, no one knows what kind of bamboo Jinju is. Okay. We do know one thing about it. It's only mentioned in Shelling Yun poems, and it pretty certainly only grows south of the Yangtze River. So if Wang Wei decides to have a Jinju Ling, you can guess that he's thinking of a Shelling Yun poem. So some of them are rustic. Some of them are the estates and lands of the least rustic of all Chinese poets, the great Shelling Yun, right? Okay. Another question we might ask. Every title, of course, has a poem by Wang Wei and one poem by Pei Di. Pei Di. Now, Pei Di was a much younger man, so these poems are probably late in Wang Wei's life. Pei Di's poems are preserved after Wang Wei's poems in Wang Wei's collection. Why? Because in a bieji, as you probably know, if you have somebody writing a poem with somebody, that poem always comes after the person whose collection it is. But that doesn't mean that's the original form. And one of the fun things to do with this, if you want to try, is sometimes to try reading the Wang Chuanji with Pei Di's poems first and Wang Wei's poems second. Then turn it around and read Wang Wei's poems first and Pei Di's poems second. And if you're a good reader, you'll get a terrible surprise that the poems are very different if you read Pei Di's poems first and Wang Wei's poem, or Wang Wei's poems first. Okay, and they probably circulated in what we call a biezhuan. A biezhuan's a small collection of poems on an occasion which circulates among people, easy to make a copy of, and eventually gets included either in a bieji or in some other kind of large work. Okay. And so now we go to titles and poems. Okay, so the first one in Wang Chuanji is Meng Cheng Ao. Now, The first question here is, I give you, in the surviving record of Chinese poetry before 750, how often is ao ever used in poetry, in a poetry title, or in an elite prose piece? And you will find it was never, ever used. It's used in lower prose, landscape stuff. It is not a elevated term. Every language has the terms that people in the countryside use for all sorts of geographical formations that people who live in the cities never ever use. Okay? Now, as I said, Huangchuan is in Lantian. It's near the capital. If there were earlier sites, especially a site called a Cheng, that must mean some sort of fortified castle or city. In the huge geographical record that survived, we would have some notice of this thing. But the problem with Mengcheng is that no one knows. People guess all sorts of things. No one knows where this place is. So what's the effect of using the thing, the phrase, Mengcheng Ao? It goes back to Xi'an. You know, Wang Wei is a Taiyuan Wang. If you know your Tang dynasty, there's Guizhu, and there's, you know, Lang Jiazi, and there's Jianmin. And this is really a Lang Jiazi, a good tax-paying families type of language, maybe. And the Guizhu are used in their poetry to have a certain level of diction maintained. And here is the famous Wang Wei, the bad boy, I think, of the Taiyuan Wangs, using this very common language, this very low-class language. And they're saying, what's that? What is Wang Wei doing, right? What does that have to do with a poem? And of course, there's Sung Zhi Wan's ownership of the same estate, to get the translation, Kung Yo, Kung Bei Xi Ren Yo. Among the many meanings that has, it's feeling bad about Sung Zhi Wan, who lived here before. Now, at this point, I should be able to, but I can't on this sort of thing, leap ahead and show you Sung Zhi Wan's poem writing on the Lantian estate. And you can see even the great Sung Zhi Wan, who is the poet of Empress Wu, right? He and Shen Quanqi are the favorites. And in Zhongzong's reign, after the death of Empress Wu, they were the ones that went to every party. As the princesses wandered through the great estates and Zhongzong and Empress Wei held their parties, he was the one that took care of the, and here is the, you know, of all people. And Sung Zhi Wan writes about the common people of Qin. So we have an issue here of what Guizhu know, what the lords know in Chang'an, and what common people know. Okay. The world that belongs to common people, and Wang Wei claims to really talk to the people and know their language. Okay. And that gives you a different sense of how the, what the poems, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the poems because, as I said, these are only beginnings. But there it is. Number two. First one is talking about esoteric, rustic knowledge of Chang'an and Lantian that the people who live in Chang'an don't know about. You guys live in your big city. Or let me ask you a question. This is a good question, my favorite questions. Is the Tang dynasty a dynasty an emperor who has an empire? Or is it an empire who has an emperor? Think about that, right? That is, who's in charge here? Is it the emperor? And I think many Tang emperors used all of China as their own personal possession. On the other hand, there is this ideology which says, if you're emperor, your chief job is to take care of the empire. And what you will see beginning to happen in the High Tang is this voice coming from the provinces saying, we own China. You know, there is a China outside Chang'an. Before, when people traveled, they wouldn't stop at the famous sites. They'd go into exile, they just travel past the sites. When you begin to have the High Tang poets, what did they do? They wrote famous poems on those sites. And everybody, after they wrote their famous poems, when they're traveling in China, they have to stop at that site and see it. And if the site burns down, you have to build another one. So that if you're passing by and want to go see the site where, you know, Cui Hao wrote a famous poem, you've got to have it there. So the names of places are places in the provinces, right, and poetry become very closely mixed together. Is the area around Chang'an merely the area around Chang'an that feeds it? Or is Qin the heart of the empire? It can have capitals. If you ever see the picture of the area, you have a capital of the Western Zhou over here. You have the capital, the Western Zhou over here. You have the Han Dynasty here. And you have the Tang over here. And then inside the Tang city is the old Ming city. So Qin doesn't matter. Qin is the heart of empire. Okay. Then let me move on to Huanzi Hill. Now, of course, here we have one of the most boring and silliest of all the poems in the whole Wang Chuanji. But what if you think of, when you say Huanzi Hill, every reader and all those Guizhu readers in Chang'an know what's going on behind it, and this is too small to read easily. But here, Shelling Yun has been reading his stories of the immortals. And he knows the famous immortal is supposed to live with other immortals on top of Huanzi Hill. He goes up Huanzi Hill to look for the immortals. I often think Shelling Yun always goes with a book in his hand. I've read about it here. I go looking for it. It's gone. He goes back down again and enjoys the landscape. Now, if we do that, and then go back, all of a sudden, when you look at Wang Wei's poem, it makes sense. Yeah, you go up, you go down Huanzi Hill, and that same feeling that Shelling Yun had is there. I built one on my estate. I've given it the name. And then Pei Di doesn't match him very well. Another thing you have to watch, so let's see, I'm going to get over here. So, as I said, no one is going to miss the Huanzi Hill reference. Right? He doesn't find the gods and immortals. He comes down. And if you keep on reading in Wang Chuanji, you realize the gods and the immortals are there. They're not gone. Okay. The next one, again, seems very strange. And let me just go and talk about the title again, but also the first line. Here's what you have to watch out for when you study your commentaries. Most commentaries give you Changman Fu as the source of the Wan Xing, right? This has nothing to do with Wang Wei's poem. It's a later poem, the Shen Yue poem, which is referring to Chang Wei, and that's the one that has, of course, the Bili the quote from the Shangwe. So what we're getting here is we're getting rustics, we're getting gods, we're getting immortals. I suppose I'm working to a vision of Wang Wei trying to create, as my time shrinks, thank goodness, a picture of, you know, Wang Wei's villa as of being basically Qin. It's a world of commoners, good farmers, a world of gods. Chang'an can burn down. It'll be rebuilt, but only because of the world of Qin. That's the old world, right? And it's a world of the immortals. Ren Jian is out there. The immortals are here. I can show you, it's also a world of peasant farmers. Now, there's one thing called Luan Jia Lai. Luan is a surname, Xing. If you go look in your reference works, we've got good reference works now, you will find out there's not one single person of the elite who has a surname Lai, or Luan rather, in the Tang Dynasty. There is a person, I think, who's an artisan, a famous artisan. So imagine what it sounded like if Wang Wei took a poem. What does that mean? Let me see, get down to the Wang Jia Lai. Oops, let's see now. Where is that? It's got to be here somewhere. It's a very nice poem. There. And I just wonder what the thing sounds like. Well, you know, these are farmers. These are farmers on Wang Wei's estate. These are tenant farmers. Now again, that's very common. I'm sure everybody, all the Guizhou in Chang'an had tenant farmers. But we don't talk about them in poetry. You never, ever let anybody know that they're there. Right? It's like Xiaoling Yun climbing the mountain with 2,000, you know, workers. But it sounds like when you read his poem, he's all by himself. This is the first move of Tang, you know, the first time in Tang, you try to let people know about the real, you know, you somewhat communicate the real world behind the imaginary world of Shanshui, the imaginary world of the great estates. My time is completely up, and that's good. So I suppose the conclusion is, if you look, get rid of Buddhism, and you look at all these things, you find a very, very different version of the, you know, Chang'an, the world of Qin. You will find other people writing about that world. It makes sense when you look at the way in which people wrote about that same area in the time of the Empress Wu and the Taiping Princess. That was the world of gods. The gods now are more elusive. The peasants are back. They're still there. You can go through the whole Tang Dynasty and start looking for this poetry. Indeed, you'll find people are constantly returning to the image of Qin as the heartland, as the home. Like the Roman Empire, people would write about Rome, and they write about Latium. That's the land in which Rome sits. And again, who has the empire? Is the empire that city, or is the empire that land? And this is the first attempt you see begin to build the notion of Qin as the land. Thank you.
Thanks for your amazing sharing. Please have your seat on the stage. Thank you. Next, let's welcome Dr. Huang to host the forum. 让我们欢迎 Dr. Stephen Owen, 徐国能教授、胡晓珍所长、郑玉瑜教授以及黄静新副院长上台来座谈。请观众将提问单交给现场的工作人员。
接下来就让我们把时间交给黄副院长。
Thank you, Professor Owen, for your wonderful and illuminating talk. After Professor Owen's talk, we invite three distinguished scholars to elaborate on what he said. The first one we invite is Professor Zheng Yuyu 院士，国立台湾大学讲座教授。Let me say a few words about her.Professor Yuyu Zheng is a faculty member at the Department of Chinese Literature at the National Taiwan University. She received her doctoral degree in Chinese Literature from National Taiwan University and has taught at her alma mater since her graduation in 1990. She was also recently elected as Academician of Academia Sinica. Her research focuses on Chinese literature criticism, aesthetics of the Six Dynasty, and the old full style poetry. Now, please, Professor Zheng.
Thank you, Mr. Wang's introduction. Today, I'm very happy to be here.那对我来说，这真的是一场很奇妙的重逢啊。那我首先讲一下呢，我跟 Professor Steve Owen 的认识，大概是我在博士班毕业以前就认识这个 Steve。I'm always your student one, right? 所以今年四月 ，Professor Owen 在他的这个荣退的这个国际会议上呢。他一看到我就说啊，你这个永远是我认识的那个研究生啊。那大概至今应该30多年了啊，认识 Steve。那Steve 有没有改变呢？其实没有很大改变，除了胡子的造型不太一样以外，其他都一样的啊。他永远是一个不会墨守成规，不满足于现成说法。那永远希望能够一直挑战现成说法的一个人，所以每次读他的书呢，真的是让人眼光一亮，非常惊艳。那今天这场演讲呢，也让我觉得充满新意啊。Steve 其实上周六也有一个正式的演讲，他讲的是竹。我们常说成竹在胸，可是其实 Steve 谈到说，不只是胸中之竹。还有吃下去的腹中之竹，他由这个小例子呢来说明国学跟汉学之间的相关性。其实今天也是一样，这个演讲呢，其实 Steve 的文章还没有全部讲完，但是大家可以知道他从哪些小地方入手啊，比方说鹿柴，大家知道王维的鹿柴这首诗，那很多人会觉得那跟佛学有关，可是其实 Steve 认为那就是 deer fence, right? 就是一个围着鹿不让它跨越到外面的一个栅栏。从这个小地方入手呢，但是不会停留于小地方。刚刚 Steve 谈到说，这个 small things will lead to larger things, right? 所以它会引导到一个大问题。那所以今天呢，这个我就简单分享一下我听 Steve 演讲完之后想到的几个大问题。比方说第一点呢，宇文教授提到，我最喜欢他提到这个栾家赖的栾这个 surname 啊，他不是一个氏族大姓，所以显然栾家赖这个地方要怎么理解文学上的这个地方，其实他挑战我们很多新的这个说法。比方说以唐代之前，我们就总会想到汉大赋，那就是一个帝国的眼光。我们会想到谢灵运的三居赋，那是士族的眼光。那现在栾家赖这个栾，他就是一个 farmer, 他就是一个农夫，所以他是怎么看待这个地理的呢？如果没有帝国的眼光，没有士族的经济利益，没有宗教的象征，你要怎么重新诠释你看到的诗的这个地理，或者这个诗文中的空间？ 所以其实对于人文地理或者文学地理，我们还有很多开拓的角度。我想现场很多人对这个议题都很感兴趣啊。那第二个问题就来了，如果我们用地方取代朝代，我们怎么重新看待文学上的作品的分歧？比方说我们常会说汉代为什么有汉大赋，因为这是一个大的帝国啊，所以它有汉大赋。可现在 Steve 告诉我们说不行，朝代不是唯一的标准，那你怎么看待文学呢？嗯，比方说 Steve 很我记得从前 Steve 讲过说，李白跟王维在写诗，不是，李白跟杜甫在写诗的时候，他不会心中想说我正在写着盛唐诗。嗯，同样的道理，建安诗人，比方说曹氏父子、建安妻子，也不会说我正在写着慷慨磊落的建安诗，不会的。所以这些诗都是后人给他的评价跟定名。如果是这样，我们该怎么重读文学史呢？为什么我们给他盛唐呢？为什么我们给他建安？所以这其实是非常挑战我们对文学史的说法。更何况其实 Steve 还有一个更颠覆性的东西，他说其实很多诗啊，诗人在写诗的时候，其实他手中有一个诗句的百宝箱，就是 poetic material， just like a box。 所以在那个诗的百宝箱里面，很多诗人是从那里找出很多典故、很多字句。所以你怎么判定这首诗的写作的朝代呢？你会不会因为这首诗有乐府诗的因素，你就说哦，这一定是早期的作品？可是这其实是不一定的。好，那最后一个例子我要举的是说关于诗学的问题啊。Professor Owen 在他的一本很有名的书《The End of the Chinese Middle Ages》，他就提到说，这个贾岛呢，不是有一首很有名的一句是“鸟树池边树，声敲月下门”吗？那在这个记载里面，不是说他对敲月下门还是推月下门有很多斟酌？很多人，我想我们我也是一样，我们看到这个故事大概说啊，这个人非常讲究这个用字。可是呢 Steve 从这个一字之差呢，他其实提出来说，到了中唐以后，诗的创作观是把诗这件事当作一个这个非常技术性的、高度技术性的事情，而不再是我们想象的心情的自然流露。这个对中国诗学的发展其实是非常非常重要的，因为我们不会想到诗者自之所知也，在心为字，发言为诗，或者是刘勰讲的心生严厉文明，这些到了中唐仿佛都要有不同的解释了。那我随便举一个例子，最后举一个有意思的例子，贾岛他是怎样得到他的好的句子？他是骑驴行吟，他是骑驴在路上背一个破锦囊，哎，得到一个句子就丢进那个锦囊。回家晚上呢，他的太太跟侍女都帮他准备好晚餐，他好吃完以后呢，再把这些锦囊打开，里面的句子请他的这个仆人帮他抄写。他说这是一个 routine， 像一个工作机器一样。可是你记不记得晋书的阮籍传？他也是骑着驴啊。他说他率意独驾，不由径路。车机所穷则痛哭而返。那个故事是告诉我们说，哎，阮籍的咏怀诗跟现实处境有关，跟历史时期有关。可是贾岛或者李贺的例子告诉我们说，写诗跟这些可能没有很大的关系，他们就是要呕心沥血的苦吟，就像一个技术工人一样好好的来写诗。所以其实 Steve 从这个斟酌的一字之差呢，就告诉我们诗学的创作观从中唐以后有了很大的改变。最后呢，这个 Steve 前几天告诉我跟小珍说，今天的座谈呢要放一点，就是要有趣一点。我这几天一直在想怎么样是有趣的。那但是看完 Steve 的文章之后，我觉得的确有趣的地方，就是他让我沉迷在很多的问题里面。我想那对我来说就是最乐此不疲的事情了。嗯，好，谢谢。
好，
那个谢谢这个郑教授 ，Thank you, Professor Zheng. Now we come to second discussion. Professor 胡晓珍，胡晓珍是现在中央研究院中国文哲研究所的研究员兼所长。Professor 晓珍 who currently serves as the director of the Institute of Chinese Literature and Philosophy.At Academia Sinica, she studied under the late Patrick Helen and received her doctoral degree from Harvard University. Besides serving as a research fellow at Academia Sinica, she has also held visiting professorship at institutions around the world, including Harvard University and Kyoto University in Japan. Her research focusOn Ming-Qing narrative literature, Ming-Qing women's literature, as well as Lei Qing and early Republican literature. Now, Professor Hu.
那么诚如刚才黄副院长所说，我的研究领域呢，其实是明清以降啊，所以是比较晚期的文学。那么对于中古文学呢，就是研究不够，所以呢，我就不敢进入这个Professor Owen 刚才演讲的这个核心当中，因为我怕贻笑于方家，这个工作呢就留给郑教授，还有刚才还有待会儿要讲的这个徐教授。那么我想我就会以一个这个Professor Owen 的老学生这样的一个身份啊，来跟在场的各位，我猜很多都是同学们哈。那么跟在场的许多的同学们来聊一聊，跟着 Professor Owen 这样的老师来学习是什么感觉，是什么经验，然后会得到什么影响啊？其实呢，当然我说是老学生是真的，因为是很多年以前，但我不会说是几年以前。那么在过去的这一个礼拜呢，其实我至少有两次突然有一种回到青春的感觉，这并不是因为我用了什么有效的面膜，而是呢我参加了两次唐奖的活动啊。那么第一次当然就是唐奖的颁奖典礼。那么唐奖的颁奖典礼上面呢，除了这个得奖人的致辞之外呢，也放了一段，给每一个人都放了一个短的这个 video。 那么 Professor Owen 在这个 video 里面呢，他就在里面就用充沛的感情的声音吟唱了一句 You want to do it again today?恰似一江春水向东流。当我听到 Professor Owen 吟到这一句的时候呢，我的脸上就是不由自主地露出了一个大大的笑容，而且不瞒各位说，在我的心里呢，则是爆裂出这个一连串不可遏制的这个笑声。不是在不这个这是完全是好的意思，就是说因为就完全就是 instantly 把我带到了若干年前，当我还在 Professor Owen 的课堂上面的时候啊。那我就在想，这岂不就是正好就是那一首当年带给我非常大的痛苦的那首作品吗？而竟然今天在这个唐奖的颁奖典礼上，我又听到我的老师呢吟唱出他的最后一句。好，那么前几天当我跟这个老师在讨论今天应该要用什么方式来讲的时候呢，那么确实老师就说我们今天应该要好玩一点。好，那么事实上老师也提到说，好玩这个 have fun。其实是文学艺术以及学术研究的中心核心。如果你自己都不觉得好玩的话，这怎么做得下去呢？怎么可能把学术当成一辈子的志业呢？好，那么我要诚实的跟大家说，我们老师呢在课堂上面讲课呢，他永远都是 have fun 的，因为呢他永远都可以有一个新的视角讲出新的东西，然后把我们这些学生们都唬得一愣一愣的。那我觉得他是乐在其中。
那么对于学生来说呢，这个感觉就比较复杂了，各位可以想象吧。好，那么当你是一个学生的时候，你听到老师用这么奇特这么有趣的视角来给一个 lecture， 然后带领我们的讨论的时候，其实我们的心中是掺杂着惊奇 surprise那当然有许多的愉悦，因为可以听到这么精彩的一个论述，同时呢也往往有迷惘，因为我没听懂，或者是甚至是惊骇，说天哪，有人这么聪明，那我们怎么办？好，所以呢那个是一个很复杂的一个感觉。well， 那么我就分享一个例子，时间过得真快， OK， 我就分享一个例子。那么当我们上到这个南唐诗的时候，哦，有一天期待当中啊，终于有一天我们要上到李后主的《虞美人》了，大家都会背对吧？春花秋月何时了，往事知多少，小楼昨夜又东风，故国不堪回首月明中，雕栏玉砌应犹在，只是朱颜改，问君能有几多愁，恰似一江春水向东流。好，那么这首我想在座的可能你五岁的时候就会背了，我们背了一辈子。好，可是呢在课堂上上到这个作品的时候， Professor Owen 问说，我要问在座的中国学生，这个中国学生当然只是中国学生，台湾学生，好，这简单的说就是受过中完整的这个中文训练的学生，我要问在座的这个中国学生，这首作品为什么好？ OK， 好，很不幸的，在场的中国学生只有现在在哥伦比亚大学任教的商伟教授跟这个来自台湾的我。我是不知道商伟教授当时是什么感觉，我自己是觉得哎呀，五内俱焚啊，就是肠子都搅在一起，要怎么样回答这个问题呢？这个作品岂不就是我们在这个When we get emotional， 当我们在某一种情绪之下会自然而然会想到的作品吗？当我们在异国异乡花前月下突然心生悲感的时候，会像我刚才那样吟诵出来一个作品吗？这样难道不够吗？好，不过他说不够。 OK， 好，那么其实我到现在也还没能给我自己一个满意的答案，当然更无法给老师一个满意的答案，说为什么这个作品是有趣的，是好的，最重点是可以被分析的。好，那么其实呢我刚刚举的这个例子只不过是我在老师的课堂上面的许多的这个惊讶以及迷惘的经验当中的一个。好，那么以前老师的上课的方式，我不知道现在是不是还是这样，就是老师会先给一个 lecture， 然后呢我们会一起读作品，而每一个学生呢会轮流的来负责翻译这个作品。现在还是这样吗？哎，太好了，因为我觉得我从这个过程当中学习到非常多。如果在座有同学你也在细读作品的时候，什么是细读呢？当我们在被迫做翻译的时候是不得不细读的，因为我们老师会给我们很多很多的从古到今的注解，对不对？但是就像刚才老师示范给我们的，我们就不能够完全的相信那些注解，而且呢那些注解往往真的就是不能够回答我的问题。当我要每一个句子把它清楚的陈述出来的时候，我会发现第一个，这个传统诗词没有办法清楚的陈述出来哈。第二个呢，就是注解往往它就是会遗漏我最需要得到指点的那个地方，那这往往就是那个关键之处。而我们呢就要 we have to begin with the small things， 就是从一个 word choice， 一个你不能够理解的很最小的事情，例如题目的一个地名等等，开始来思考。那么这个过程我自己在学习的当时一开始可能不够理解，但我觉得在这整个比较长久的一个学习过程之中，它的意义就会呈现出来。那我也必须说，我觉得跟我当时的受西方教育长大的同学相比，事实上我觉得对他们来说其实是比较容易更快的去抓住这个学习当中的应该要学到的东西的。 反而对于受过完整的古典文学教育的人来说比较难。为什么？因为我们有许许多多的传统，因为我们有许许多多的成见，所以呢，对于我们来说，对于我来说，这个学习的过程正是要一层一层的去先剥掉我身上穿的那些成见的外衣，先进入到那个文本的最细微之处啊。并不是不要那些传统，并不是不要那些注解所能够给我们的指引，而是我必须要有能力去直接去进入这个 text， 对不对？好，那么也像刚才老师说的在他的文章里面讲的，我们要进入这个 text， 而且要进入这个 text 被产生出来、被创作出来的时候呢，一个特殊的情境，而不是靠着后人的理解来形成我自己的理解。好，那么我的时间其实已经早就超过了，但我必须要说虽然我并没有成为一个中古文学的研究者，但是在这个学习过程中，我所得的其实是指引着我后来做明清以及明清以后的文学，去找资料、去找问题以及看文本的时候一个极重要的关键。那么我必须要谢谢我的老师当时给我的这些礼物，同时我也觉得希望可以借这个机会把这个礼物也送给在场的各位同学们，希望将来大家在做学术进行学术工作的时候，也可以从今天老师的 lecture 里面得到启发，而不是得到一个知识。好，谢谢。
那个谢谢胡晓生教授。 Thank you Professor 胡晓生 for your remarks. Now we come to the third discussant, Professor 许国能，他是现在国立师范大学国文系的教授。 Professor 国能许 is a faculty member at the Department of Chinese at the National Taiwan Normal University, which is also his alma mater, where he received his doctoral degree. Prior to joining the NTNU faculty, he has been taught at Danjiang University. Professor Xu is an expert in classic and modern Chinese literature and has published widely in these fields. Now, Professor Xu.
谢谢。那今天首先是非常感谢唐奖基金会安排欧文先生在师大为我们讲述他对唐诗研究的思考，因为师大不仅是一个研究机构，同时也是一个非常重要的教育机构。而诗歌的教育，也就是所谓的诗教，一直是儒家教育的一个核心。所以我相信呢，欧文先生和前面两位大师的意见，不仅能够提供我们崭新的研究视野，同时也可以让我们重新思考诗歌和教学的普及工作在这个时代的价值还有意义是什么。在座也许有些朋友师长并不是那么了解欧文先生历来的著作，那么我想以我的经验来跟大家分享我在欧文先生学术成就当中所获得的东西。从我学生时代开始一直到今天，欧文先生的研究一直给我许多的启发。我最早读的作品像是初唐诗，像是盛唐诗，像是 中国早期古典诗歌的生成，中国中世纪的终结等等，这些作品其实在今天欧文先生所提到的这个从小的事物开始，那么其实在欧文先生早期的著作当中就可以见到一些端倪。例如在中国中世纪的终结 The End of the Chinese Middle Ages 这本书里面，他以一首我们并不太重视的杜甫诗叫做水涧，涧就是木字边一个那个监察院的监，那个水涧为例， 他指出了杜甫诗中对小的事物的书写，既有一种小中见大的诗歌，就是充满了隐喻跟象征的诗歌，同时也有另一种并不涉及国家社稷，而是属于杜甫自己私人空间的一种书写。这个说法非常的具有歧视。我们知道从宋朝开始，对于杜甫诗是不是每一首都别有寄托，常常有严重的分歧。而我认为这种分歧的根源或许就是混淆了欧文先生所说的这两种 small 的类型。也就是说，我们是不是要把杜甫始终看成是一个无时无刻不在忧国忧民的一个诗人，还是他也有一些自己的私人空间？而后呢，我还读到了欧文先生的著作《中国文论：音译与批评》，那么里面也给我许多的灵感。例如说，其中有一章讲到的是所谓的通俗诗学。我们在座如果熟悉中国文学的朋友，听到通俗两个字，想到的也许是小说、戏曲。那可是以诗歌这种较为典雅的文体，有没有可能产生通俗的情况呢？事实上，在欧文先生的研究里面指出了这样子一类的作品，这也引发我重新思考诗歌从贵族走向平民所历经的量变跟质变，以及这些经典作品在这种过程中重新诠释与经典化的意义何在。那么欧文先生他在近年这几年有很了不起的学术成就。首先呢，他编辑了《剑桥中国文学史》，我相信在座也许有些朋友读过这个书。那么更重要的是，欧文先生他在这几年翻译了全部1400多首的杜甫诗，甚至包括了杜甫写的赋篇。这以中文来讲都是非常困难的作品，但是欧文先生的努力让他们得以推向西方英文的读者世界。中国的诗歌因为文化语言的因素，翻译是很困难的。其实在过去也出现了一些很奇特的现象。例如在19世纪，有一位法国的女诗人写了一本书叫做《白玉诗书》，那么其中有杜甫诗14首，但其中12首杜甫诗都是这位女诗人 Judith 她自己帮杜甫创作的，所以杜甫根本没有写过那些诗歌。在20世纪早期，美国的诗人庞德他的著名的诗集叫做《神州集》，还有另外两位女诗人，这个艾斯科跟这个洛威尔，他们合作翻译的《松花间》在西方的世界影响也非常的大，有一些读者，但是他们的翻译往往受到了意象主义的影响，因此他们和真正的杜甫诗之间是有一种距离的。那如果说以真正的比较好的翻译在上一个世纪来说，可能是鸿业他所写的作品叫做《杜甫中国最伟大的诗人》，杜甫 Chinese the Greatest Poet， 还有一位英国的这个学者 David Hawkes 他写的 Little Pride of Doof。 这两本书呢，虽然翻译的都比较精准一点，但是这两位学者都只做了部分的翻译。那么能够把所有的杜甫诗以英文面世，让西方读者能够全面理解中国诗圣的思想跟诗歌艺术，那么欧文先生他的这个著作为我们的诗学还有中西文化的交流提供了超越前人的一种贡献。但是在今天的演讲中，欧文先生不谈他这个非常了不起的精于碧海式的一种伟大的贡献，而要我们读诗从小的地方小处着眼。的确在熟悉的语言和意象当中，让我自己读诗的时候也常常想当然而或是不求甚解。在研究的过程中，面对唐诗这个已经被大量关注的文本， 我们该如何找到新的可能呢？这也是我常常在问自己的问题。但正如欧文先生今天所说的，我们在诗歌的细微之处的沉吟和玩味，也许可能在学术上产生新的发现。而这样的过程，我个人也认为同时也能增进我们读诗的趣味。我想在座的许多朋友也许和我一样，最早是因为诗歌的美、诗歌的趣味而开始读诗的。所以怎么样在研究之余重新找回这种对美、对诗歌趣味的一种执着，我觉得从小处开始也许是一个非常好的一个方法。最后如果时间允许，我想冒昧的请教欧文先生一个问题。您在过去和现在的研究中，杜甫的诗歌似乎是一个热点，除了刚才所说的翻译以外，您也常以他的诗篇作为举证的范例。我想知道这是因为在中国文学史中，杜甫诗作为一个经典，它本身贯穿了许多议题，例如说诗应该抒情还是记事，或是今天的大跟小的问题，还是因为欧文先生您自己对杜甫诗歌的内容还有它的艺术性怀抱着一份热情呢？而我们又该用什么样的眼光来看待历史留给我们的文化遗产？这是我的浅见，谢谢您，谢谢。
Thank you, Professor Xu, for having shared with us your understanding of Professor Owen's scholarship. Professor Owen, will you respond to his question?
I guess I simply like Dufu. And when I find a topic that seems to be important, then somehow I think of the Dufu poem that actually embodies the topic. So that, I think, to answer your question.I don't quite know how to answer. There's a lot of things in there. So I'll just wait for questions from the audience. But certainly, and Dufu was one more thing. Sometimes when he's, sometimes Dufu went from the large thing to the small thing. He's ironic.
那从现在开始我们open to the floor. 我们现在开始可以跟那个语文教授提问。那因为刚才有好几位的听众已经把他们的问题写在这个纸上，那我们请胡晓珍教授跟这个语文教授说明。We collect all the questions there, so the professor who please do the favor for us.
There are quite many. Should I just start reading the first question?
You can, yes.
Okay, right. The first question is offered by Mr. Li Mingzhe from 翻译研究所, and he asked, "You said there is no major Tang writer whose work can be accurately described by one character. Does that mean you applied different strategies or perspectives?" When translating different Tang poets? That's the question.
That's an interesting question. That's a very good question. And I think when you're trying to translate and catch the quality of an author, you both try to adapt, you have to try to keep a single voice for an author, but you have to change that voice depending on what you're talking about.So sometimes if Dufu is very serious and sad, you have to be serious and sad. When Dufu is mixing very Wanyara, Gaoyara language with very Dina language, then you have to catch the irony. If you don't, you miss the poem.
这个问题是by Professor 李振清. Do you know him personally?
I think so, yeah. He's right there, right?
I'm sorry.
I know.
Oh, Professor
Lee. I thought that was Lee Jiaqing.
Okay. Of course, Professor Lee is a very renowned scholar.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
And 他的提问内容, he actually has two questions. The first one, Chinese has been regarded as one of the most challenging and critical languages in the world. How were you motivated to master this as an expert of Tang poetry? So, you know, and the second one is 简体字. It's 简体字, I'm sorry.
While serving as a director of memory
suitable to study
this university, I heard a lot of American scholars from Harvard, Princeton, Yale, going back to Du Fu Chao Tang in Chengdu, and then discovered that Chinese in China today have difficulty appreciating and understanding the Du Fu poems in Du Fu Chao Tang. So how would you interpret or, think about the impact of 简体字 on the development of Tang poetry as a sustainable literatures in Chinese civilization? Thank you.
Okay, that was two questions. The first question is, what drove me to do Chinese? I sometimes ask that question to myself. it takes a long time. It's not the only very difficult literature, though, in the world. All literatures which involve memorization of large corpuses have developed these kind of complications. Could give you examples, but I won't. I think 简体字probably doesn't matter. It's rather the way in which the language has drifted. I think people and the certain ideas about learning Chinese. And the Chinese we have to face the fact the Chinese, classical Chinese, the language of Du Fu, is no longer the native language of anyone. It always takes work to get there. If I want to read Shakespeare, I have to work, even though I'm a native speaker. I may feel good about it, but I find I'm not pronouncing it right. Just like every Mandarin speaker is not pronouncing it right. Okay? So that for all these things, you know, it doesn't come easily. And sometimes people find it easier, sometimes Chinese readers find it easier to look at a translation and then read the Du Fu poem in the original than just to look at the original cold. And Du Fu is perhaps one of the most difficult for many reasons, not just the Diangu, but also for the way he uses the language. I think in the Song Dynasty, they couldn't read Du Fu very well anymore because the language had changed so much between the Tang and the Song. Thank you.
The next question is by Mr. Chen Tianxiang from National Taiwan University. 他的问题是用中文写的，他说，目前中国中古史学界对于史料批判 I guess like critical understanding of historical raw materials 与历史书写 historical writing 就是，one concerning the method of Yeah. The method of theoretical framework. The 议题，史料批判与历史书写的议题十分关注。您认为中古文学研究界对于这一议题能否提供专业理论资源与研究方法，从而推进中古文史的研究？
This is a hard question. First, I think it's good to study these things. It's very hard because the way history is taught is perhaps not the way you would need to do cultural history. Certainly, literary criticism can teach you, and critical theory can teach you a lot of things, but not really to read a Chinese poem. And what you do is, I have a great faith that if you read a text carefully, the text will tell you what to do. The text, you know, creates its own issues, if you know the historical context. And to know all these things is very good, but it really has to be reused, reconfigured for every single poem or prose piece. And every time I spend a lot of time on a poem or a lot of time on a piece of prose, I find I have to invent again the way, in fact, we under middle, you know, it's middle Chinese, you know, middle period, teaching me how to read literature. Is that a fair answer?
Next question by, I guess, Mr. Zhang Kaiyi from 政治大学. 他的问题也是中文的. 他说, 宇文所安先生在晚唐诗, 一书中提及, 李贺的诗歌, 及其艺术风格, 那么其中许多的想法, 概念和您的文章, 断片, 所论, 有所关联。 那么可否就此多谈谈呢?
This is broad.
可否就此多谈谈, 就是这两者之间的关联, 李贺诗歌的艺术风格跟断片里面提到的。 还有第二个, 他说, 今天的会议主题是从小开始, 那么, beginning with the small things, 对于李贺诗, 有哪一些小地方, 小处是可以切入的呢? 还有这个, 他的, 还有以诗轨, 著称的这个建构, 是怎么建构来的? 就是why, 他什么时候变诗轨的? 您有何想法? 他非常诚挚感谢您的回应。
If you read a lot of Lei Tang, you realize Li He is everywhere. There's no way around it. And Li He does, you know, people say people did, not many people read Li He, but of course Li He goes directly into Ci. In many, many ways, Li He phrases are all over the place. So he had an immense impact. But as the Song Dynasty reconstructed their canon of Tang poetry, Li He was not central to that. So I think that's fair enough to say. Obviously, this is the whole model, the Shama Shama of Shur, the, you know, the Sheng of Shur, the Shen of Shur, and this is, he's a latecomer in this. He has to get a name, and they gave him one. But, you know, his, not, that does, that covers many poems. It doesn't cover all of them. Right? So again, the Li He is a bit more broader, even though quite, he's, that really is quite, stands out. He is a, does many different kinds of things. I guess that's about all you can say, except for this. Because
next one is a big one. It's actually a challenge.
Okay.
Ready for that?
Okay.
I know you always welcome challenges. Okay. 失穷而后功, 是无才气者, 才会苦吟诗句, 碾断树根须。
When I was talking about Chuantong, I'm talking about basically taking the kind of learning people had in the late Qing and Republican eras often, combined with whatever you get in May 4th revision of that, and taking that as if it represented the past as a whole. I'm very interested in the relationship to the past, very much so. But when you take the past and lump it into one thing, then you fail, because the Tang was not reading the same poems and was not reading it the same way as the Song. Now the Song had a lot more influence than the Tang itself, but the Song's interests were very different from the interests of the Ming and Qing. So what you have is you have layers upon layers of different moments in history, and the interests of those particular moments that are no longer relevant for the 20th century, but they've just become institutionalized, as it were, as the tradition. These things have no basis in the original usage. Then you don't need, you should know them, you should respect them, but you don't need to follow them. That frees us to know that you have to tong bian, right? Bian or tong. And only by changing and keeping the literature going for our own age will it continue. You can't preserve it. If you preserve it, it dies. I think that's fairly.
Thank you. We are very grateful we have a fruitful dialogue between Professor Owen and our audience. And even a wonderful party needs to come to an end. Thank you to all of you for your participation, good health, and wish everything is going well with you. 谢谢大家今天的参与.
Thank you all for coming.
Yeah. 那我们再一次的, 谢谢大家, 祝大家身体健康, 万事如意, 谢谢.
Thanks to all our distinguished guests. Please come under the stage and have your seats. We will have a group photo now.